All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him and we seek His forgiveness. And we send peace and blessings on the final and most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All you who believe, fear Allah, the fear He is most deserving of, and do not die unless in a state of Islam. Khwani, as the month of Ramadan is around the corner, a month in which if a person worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly on the way of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and sincerely for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can guarantee you Jannah bi-idhnillah. Ikhwani, for any action in the religion of Allah, in the Sharia of Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for any action to be accepted in the religion of Islam, it must satisfy two pillars or two conditions. The month of Ramadan comes and falls under this category. Any act of worship, your salah, your siyam, your hajj, your umrah, your zakah, your da'wah, your jihad, even your martyrdom, your shahada fi sabilillah, if it's lacking one of two main components, it will be nullified. Even if it's jihad. Even if it's shahada, dying in the path of Allah, even if it's dying in the path of Allah. The first component, ikhwani, the first pillar of any action to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that it needs to be on the way of Muhammad ibn Abdullah. It needs to be on the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A person cannot attempt to pray duha 5 rak'at or 6 rak'at or 7 rak'at or even 4 rak'at. Even if they're sincere, Allah will not accept it from them. So it needs to be on the way of Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Your fasting of Ramadan needs to be on the sunnah of Muhammad. Your qiyam, your salah, your siyam, your zakat, all your acts of worship needs to be within the parameters of the Sharia on the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I dare say, ikhwani, that the majority of us in this department will pass bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal, especially in the fasting of the month of Ramadan. I dare say that the majority of the Muslims know how to fast in the month of Ramadan. They know the ahkam of siyam. They know what breaks your fast, what nullifies it, when is Salat al-Fajr, you know how to have suhoor, how to break your fast. That's quite simple knowledge. Some patches of and gaps of knowledge here and there exist, we need to fill them up and get our knowledge from the right sources. However, unfortunately, where the majority of us, including myself, have fallen short is in the second pillar. As we said, any action has two pillars to be accepted by Allah. The first pillar is al-mutaba'ah, on the way of Muhammad. The second pillar, ikhwani, it needs to be sincerely done for the sake of Allah. It needs to be done solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You could pray, you can fast, you can go to jihad, you can go to umrah, you can go to hajj, you can donate all your wealth and come on the day of judgment and get rewarded zilch, nothing, if it's not done solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once sitting down in a gathering, perhaps similar to this one, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was teaching the companions. So a man came in and asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger, أَرَأَيْتَ رَجُلًا غَزَى. O Messenger, if a man goes out in the path of Allah in jihad, غَزَى, ikhwani, you know what غَزَى means? غَزَى is the person leaves his wife, his children, his business, everything behind him, and goes in the path of Allah in jihad. أَرَأَيْتَ رَجُلًا غَزَى يَبْتَغِي الْأَجْرَ وَالذِّكْرَ مَا لَهُ. So this man comes and asks the Prophet, O Messenger, if a person goes out in the path of Allah in jihad, to war, to battle, يَبْتَغِي الْأَجْرَ, this person wants hasanat from Allah, wants the reward from Allah, وَالذِّكْرَ, and also he wants to be mentioned. He wants to be mentioned that so-and-so is a mujahid. He wants to be mentioned that he is a striver in the path of Allah. He is a worker for the sake of Allah. He is a mujahid fi sabilillah. He wants to be mentioned. So he asked the Prophet, ما له? What does he get? The Prophet ﷺ said, لا شيء. Nothing. So the man thought, maybe the Prophet did not hear me. Maybe I didn't explain myself properly. Maybe a word, you know, was lost in translation, as they say. So he repeated the question and he said, Ya Rasulullah, أَرَأَيْتَ رَجُلًا غَزَى يَبْتَغِي الْأَجْرَ وَالذِّكْرِ. A man goes out, غَزَى, goes out in the path of Allah. This man can go in the path of Allah, and possibly, it is possible that he may not come back. He'll die as a martyr. Or it is possible that he'll go out in the path of Allah and lose an arm, lose a leg, be held as captive. It's jihad fi sabilillah, anything can happen. So he asked, ما له, what does he get? So the Prophet said for the second time, لا شيء, nothing. So the man repeated the question for the third time. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا شيء, nothing. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبَلُ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ إِلَّا مَا كَانَ خَالِصًا وَابْتُغِيَ بِهِ وَجْهُهُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only accepts from the deed what was pure for His sake subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it was done solely for Him. Even jihad fi sabilillah, even jihad fi sabilillah. So ikhwani, the month of Ramadan is around the corner. A month in which if a person observes fasting correctly, bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can save you from hellfire on because of your fasting in the month of Ramadan. If a person worships Allah correctly in the month of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make you from those that are guaranteed Jannah. However, my question to you, are our deeds ready to be given to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They are done on the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one here is claiming that Ramadan is in Rajab or Sha'ban or, you know, at the end of the year. No, no, we fast the month of Ramadan when it's due. And inshallah we'll break our fast when it's due. So the way of Muhammad, being following the Sunnah of Muhammad, I don't think there's an issue there. How sincere are our actions? Is it done for the sake of Allah? Your salat, your siyam, your qiyam, your donations, are they done for the sake of Allah or are they done for otherwise? قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us what to say. And not only what to say, but what to live by. What is your code of conduct? Say that my salah, my prayers, my nusuk, my haya, my living and my death, it's for the sake of Allah. La sharika lah. No partners are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith al-Qudsi, أَنَا أَغْنَى الشُّرَكَاءِ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا أَشْرَكَ فِيهِ مَعِيَ غَيْرِي تَرَكْتُهُ وَشِرْكُهُ. I, what translates to mean, I am the least of the partners that need a partner. أَغْنَى الشُّرَكَاءِ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ. I do not need a partner. I'm the last of the partners that needs a partner. I'm the one that, literally the one that never ever needs a partner. If a person does a deed and associates a partner with me, I shall leave him and his shirk. Do you know what this hadith means, ikhwani? It means that if a person's praying, if a person fasts the month of Ramadan, if a person donates in the path of Allah in the month of Ramadan and outside it, and his deeds whilst on the way of Muhammad are not sincere for the sake of Allah, it is seen in the eyesight of Allah as shirk, as associating a partner with Allah. This is how heavy this issue is, ikhwani. This issue is a very scary and a dangerous issue, ikhwani. My job here is not to scare you so much that you actually stop doing good deeds. But rather, ikhwani, I'm here to remind myself and every single brother and sister, if there are any sisters, that our deeds need to be sincerely done for the sake of Allah so that we can get rewarded for them. So that we can be saved on the day of judgment. So that our deeds would take us to Jannah as opposed to Jahannam, wal-iyadu billah. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, the first Khalifa of the Muslims. I want you to imagine this man. This man was an old man in his 60s. This man was the Khalifa of the Muslims where there was no previous Khalifa. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away and the Muslims gathered on Abu Bakr and he became the Khalifa of the Muslims. Abu Bakr, the Khalifa of the Muslims, he was leading Fajr prayer and he would leave the prayer. After the prayer, he would leave straight away and go about his business. For the first day, week two, nobody said anything. Nobody sort of had an issue with it. Up until Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he was curious. Where does the Khalifa of the Muslims, he finishes his prayer, he's leading us in prayer, he finishes the prayer, then he gets up and leaves. What is more important than staying with the Muslims and leading them and guiding them and giving them, you know, that guidance, etc.? What is more important than that? So Umar radiallahu anhu decided, I shall follow Abu Bakr. I want to see what Abu Bakr is up to. Umar radiallahu anhu says, and he narrates this. He says, فَمَكَثْتُ I hid in a location. I saw Abu Bakr leaving after Fajr and entering into a house. So he said, I went into that house. I want to see what happens in that house. Whose family is it? Who is it? So Umar radiallahu anhu saw Abu Bakr enter the house, then leave it. So Umar went after the footsteps of Abu Bakr and entered the house. Knocked on the door opens, and he doesn't find much. The Khalifa of the Muslims, the number one most important Muslim on earth, was entering this house. Umar wanted to see, who is it that's in there? Is it like the Romans negotiating with us? Is it the Persians? Is he teaching people the religion? Who was it? All he saw was an empty house, hardly any furniture. And then he sees a very old lady. And listen to her description. He asked her, Ma anti? And you could imagine Umar's voice and Umar's sort of structure with his loud voice, with his strength. He looks at this old lady sitting down on the ground. He goes, Ma anti, who are you? So the woman said, Ana ajuzun, amya'u, hasira, kasira. I am an old lady who's blind, who is immobile, who is, you know, and she started to mention all the problems in the world that's with her. She can't move, she can't see, she can't talk, you know, she's not mobile, she's got no food, no water, no money, no nothing. So he told her, okay. وَمَا هَذَا الرَّجُلُ الَّذِي يَدْخُلُ عَلَيْكُمْ This man that comes in, he was referring to Abu Bakr, but he did not mention his name. هَذَا الرَّجُلُ الَّذِي يَدْخُلُ عَلَيْكُمْ This man that was coming in, who is he to you? So the old woman said, هَذَا رَجُلٌ لَا نَعْرِفُهُ This man, we don't even know who he is. يَأْتِي فَيَعْجِنُ خُبْزَنَا You know, he would make our bread. He would take out the rubbish. He'll milk our sheep. So he'll prepare the food, prepare the bread, milk the sheep, clean the house, and go. And she said, وَلَا نَعْرِفُ لَهُ إِسْمَاءُ We don't even know his name. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he heard that and he saw that, he fell on his knees and he cried, radiallahu anhu arda, and he said, أَتْعَبْتَ الْخُلَفَاءَ مِنْ بَعْدِكَ يَا أَبَا بَكْرِ Oh Abu Bakr, you have made it much harder for the khulafa, for those that want to take the leadership of the Muslims after you. Abu Bakr, the man who was guaranteed Jannah. Abu Bakr, the one that was mentioned in the Quran, ثانيثنين. Abu Bakr, the one that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, you're in Jannah, you're one of the people in Jannah. He was doing the good deed. Even the lady that he was doing the good deed for, the blind, sick, immobile, paralyzed lady, didn't even know who he was. Ikhwani, how many deeds do you have that are sincere for the sake of Allah? When was the last time you did something and nobody on the face of the planet knows that you've done it? It could be a donation. It could be Quran recitation. It could be dhikr Allah Azza wa Jal. It could be istighfar. It could be something, helping a person, you know, helping a person in their house, in their backyard, in their school, wherever it is, without them even knowing. When was the last time you helped somebody or did something for the sake of Allah without anyone knowing? Unfortunately, ikhwani, we live in a society that if I don't take a photo of myself doing the deed and publishing it on social media, it never happened. Ikhwani, you need to prepare yourself to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are you doing that deed for the sake of social media? Are you doing the deed for the sake of your Facebook friends or Instagram friends or wherever the friends they are? Or are you doing it for the sake of Allah? You're really making it harder for yourself to be sincere when you're exposing your good deeds constantly. A person goes to Umrah and he makes videos about himself in Umrah. A person is fasting. The month of Ramadan, the whole Ummah is fasting. He constantly reminds people that he is fasting. A person that donates, he makes sure that the whole world knows that he has donated. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبَلُ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ إِلَّا مَا كَانَ خَالِصًا وَابْتُغِيَ بِهِ وَجْهُ. That Allah only accepts from the deed what was sincere and it was done solely for the sake of Allah. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله إمام الخلق والمرسلين صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. One of the ahadith, إخواني, that Ali bin Abi Talib رضي الله عنه narrates to us. Ali رضي الله عنه was one of the younger companions when the migration took place, the migration from Mecca to Medina. Ali radiallahu anhu says, كُلُّ النَّاسِ هَاجَرَ سِرًّا حَتَّى النَّبِيِّ. That verily all the Muslims in Mecca that migrated to Medina, they migrated in secret, inclusive of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِلَّا Umar, except for Umar. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he wanted to migrate, Ikhwani, he wore his war armor. So basically the armor that you wear for war, it's made out of, you know, skin, whatever it is. It is a thick armor so that he can't be stabbed, he can't be hurt. So he prepared himself for war, basically. وَتَقَلَّدَ سَيْفَهُ. And he placed his sword on his side, ready to go. And he had his bow and arrow with him, radiallahu anhu, as one of the narrations say. And Umar radiallahu anhu, whilst everyone was migrating in secret, Umar radiallahu anhu was prepared himself for war. Not only that, he went around the Kaaba where all the kuffar of Quraysh were. Those were the guys who were torturing the Muslims and forced them to leave Mecca. He went around the Kaaba, did tawaf, and he started to threaten the kuffar of Quraysh who were there. And he constantly said to them, "Shahat al-wujuh." May your faces perish, may your faces perish. And then he said to them, Man arada, whomsoever wants his children to be orphaned, his wife to be widowed, his mother to cry over him, let him follow me behind this mountain. Not one person followed him. All the Muslims who were able to migrate from Mecca to Medina, migrated from Mecca to Medina. Including of a man. This man, Ikhwani, whilst the Muslims were migrating for the sake of Allah, this man was publicly telling the companions, I am migrating because I'm in love. I'm in love. I love a woman. Whilst everyone was migrating, and the migration, Ikhwani, imagine leaving your house, your business, your family, your extended family, your belongings, your everything that you have, starting fresh somewhere. There must be a really good justification for you. This man was in love with a woman called Ummi Qais. So this man migrated with the people that migrated. When the companions reached Medina, the companions came up to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they told him, Ya Rasulullah, we left our houses, we left our businesses, we left everything behind for the sake of Allah. And this guy came clearly and he says publicly, I'm here to marry a woman. Are we equal in the eyesight of Allah? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what translates to mean, The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ, that verily all of the actions are by intention. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ مْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, and verily every person shall receive what they intended for. فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, if the person's migration is for the sake of Allah and His Messenger, therefore he will receive the reward of being in the sake of Allah and His Messenger. وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا, if a person migrated for the sake of a dunya. Dunya, ikhwan, could be a business deal. Dunya could be just showing off. Dunya could be so I could make friends with this guy. Dunya could be so that I have something to write on Facebook. لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا, or for a woman that he wants to marry. And he was referring to that man who married Ummi Qais. فَهِجْرَتُهُ لِمَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ, therefore his migration is for what he has migrated for. Khwani, I dare say this hadith we learned as, yani, as one of the first hadith as we were grown up. How much of it do you apply? How much of this hadith, Ikhwani, is really in your life? That every action that you do is solely for the sake of Allah. Are we amongst those who will come on the Day of Judgment with actions as big as the mountains of Tuhama, as big as the mountains, you know, the mountain of Uhud, the mountain of the other mountains, the larger mountains? Will we come with actions as big as the mountains and Allah will destroy them because they weren't sincere for His sake? Will we be amongst those who will be dragged on their faces on the Day of Judgment and thrown into hellfire because their deeds weren't sincere for the sake of Allah? Which path do you want to choose? Who's the action for, Ikhwani? Ramadan's around the corner. Ikhwani, plant the intention from today. Plant the intention that inna salati wa nusuki, that my prayer, my nusuk, my life, my death is for the sake of Allah. Plant that everything that you shall do is for the sake of Allah. Plant that every single deed will be done discreetly unless forced to otherwise. Plant in your mind, in your heart, in your soul that everything's for the sake of Allah. If the whole world was watching or if there's no one there, it means no difference to me. One of the sunan, or the adab rather, of Yawm al-Jum'ah, the day of Friday, is to actually recite Surah Al-Kahf. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you study Surah Al-Kahf, ikhwani, one of the most beautiful surah in the Quran, talks about, as the name, you know, suggests, the people who, you know, fled their nation or their town for the sake of Allah, the young men who fled their town for the sake of Allah and stayed in a cave. Then it talks about many other things. It talks about Musa alayhi salam and the Khidr. It talks about, you know, Bani Israel. It talks about the jinn or shaitan and the people of the garden. It talks about finally towards the end of the surah about the Day of Judgment. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wraps up the surah, Ikhwani, with one verse. One verse that summarizes the whole surah. A surah, Ikhwani, that summarizes with one verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. Whomsoever, what translates to mean, whomsoever wants to meet their Lord and their Lord is pleased with them, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا, they need to put something forward. You need to do good deeds. You need to actually do something in the path of Allah. You need to pray. You need to fast. You need to do that good deed. فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ, and do not associate a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the worship of Allah. Even if it's salah, even if it's salah. If it's siyam, if it's siyam. Whatever the deed is, Ikhwani, make sure it is done solely for the sake of Allah. A question that might come to mind, Ikhwani, is how can I attain this sincerity? Ask yourself. If you want to test yourself, Ikhwani, do I do more good deeds in public than in private, or is it the other way around? If you find yourself in public, MashaAllah, you're donating and you're fasting and you're praying and you're doing Qiyam al-Layl, etc. And you're praying in Jama'ah, and. and in private you're struggling to even get up and make wudu to pray, there's a major issue there. If your acts of worship are better in private than they are in public, wallahu alam, you have attained a high level of sincerity. If the person is better in public than private, then there's an issue there. One of the best ways, ikhwani, to understand or to live the concept of ikhlas is that no matter where you are, public, private, in Hajj on the day of Arafah, at home, in your room, and the lights are off and no one can see you, wherever you are, you only see Allah, no one but Allah. It's a very high and a hard level to achieve. However, with mujahada, with struggling against the nafs, a person can attain it. A person should attain it, at least if they are on the path towards such a state. One of the main ways, ikhwani, to attain this sincerity is to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it is a form of rizq. It is sustenance from Allah. Oh Allah, grant us sincerity just like you allowed us to pray. Oh Allah, allow us to be sincere in our actions just like you allowed us to worship you. Constantly ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remind oneself and others about sincerity in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To constantly remember who your Lord is. Who you're worshipping truly. When you remember that Allah is the creator of the universe, the sustainer of everybody, the one that made me and sustained me, the one that knows everything that's in my heart, everything that's in my soul, that will force you, wallahu alam, towards sincerity a lot more. Constantly remind yourself of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And remember the day of judgment. A day that people will come with actions. Mountains full of hasanat. As we said earlier, they'll be destroyed due to the lack of sincerity. And a person will come with a small hasana. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will multiply it into multiple folds. Why? Due to the sincerity. We finish off, ikhwani, with an example of a sincere person. After the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali, and there were, you know, some turbulence, etc. here and there, we had a Khilafa called Ad-Dawla Al-Amawiyya. Walhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this Khilafa was able to expand the boundaries of the Islamic country or the Islamic fold multiple times. And whilst one of their, you know, campaign managers or one of their army commanders was surrounding a castle for the Romans, and the army commander's name was Maslama. He was, you know, surrounding this castle and trying to open it, and the Muslims were dying in the path of Allah trying to open this castle. However, whatever they did could not repel, could not open up this castle. So one day, as the Muslim soldiers were lining up in the morning to sort of, you know, advance towards the castle, and the war took place over days, they discovered that one of the Muslim soldiers at night, when no one can see him, went and dug up a trench from underneath the castle, in one narration, another narration, through the door, or one of the doors of the castle. And this Muslim soldier, who had covered his face, went from underneath the gates of the castle, fought his way, risked his life in the path of Allah, fought the guards on the door, opened the door and did takbir, said, Allahu Akbar. Once the Muslim soldiers heard the takbir and saw the doors of the castle open, they marched and they opened it by the grace of Allah. And it was a great day and a great victory day for the Muslims. So after the battle was over and the dust had settled, everyone was asking, Man sahibu naqb? Who's the man of the hole? Who's the man of the, you know, who's the man that snuck in? So everybody was asking, even the leader of the Muslim army, Maslama, was asking, who's the man, you know, the masked man? The man of the hole, they called him. Nobody answered. So the leader of the Muslim army, he said, I order him, as being the chief commander of the Muslim army, I order the man who dug that hole to reveal himself. I want to know who he is. Nobody answered. At night, when you know all the soldiers resting, etc., a man came towards the tent of the leader of the Muslim army, Maslama, and he told the soldiers, "Hey, I want to speak to the chief. I know who the person is," and he had his face covered. So they told him, "Tfaddal, come in." So the man walks in and he said, told Maslama, "I know who that person is. However, he has conditions to tell you who he is." So he told him, "What's his conditions? Tell us." He said that you do not write to the Khalifa to reward him. Told him, "Lahu dhalik," that we'll give him. And he told him that you do not give him a reward or, you know, a financial gain or whatever. Told him, "Lahu dhalik," that's for him. And that you do not ask him who he is. He told him, "Lahu dhalik." So the man, in one narration, it says he uncovered his face and he said, "Ana sahibun naqab," I am the man of the hall, and he walked off. No one can follow him. No one can ask him who he is. No one can even chase him. To this day, ikhwani, look it up. Look it up in the books of seerah. Look it up in the books of history. Sahibun naqab, the man of the hall. We don't know his name. Does it affect him? La wallah. You know who knows his name? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This man, ikhwani, to this day, no one knows who he is. However, he done that sincere action for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was narrated that Maslama, the leader of the Muslim army, from that day to the day that he died, every single time that he prayed, he said, "Allahumma hashuvni ma'a sahib al-naqb." Oh Allah, gather me on the day of judgment. With who? With sahib al-naqb, with the man of the hall. One act, ikhwani, one act can save you on the day of judgment. One act can make sure that you're from the people of Jannah. One act can save your neck on the day of judgment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the sincere ones. Ikhwani, the month of Ramadan is coming. I urge myself and you to abstain away from photos, videos, messages, taking a photo of yourself feeding a fasting person, taking a video of yourself doing an iftar, taking a video of yourself or a photo and posting it and sharing it, and ikhwani, be like the man of the hall. Do a deed for the sake of Allah. Do it and cover it up for the sake of Allah. Do it and make sure that no one knows about it, so that deed can come on the day of judgment, bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal, and save us from the hell of fire with the mercy of Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who listen, understand, and implement. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us sincerity in this dunya and the akhirah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes this month of Ramadan a blessed month for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I wanna be in Jannah, Jannah, yeah. Jannah, Jannah. Every Muslim dreams to be up in Jannah. Pious person's destiny. Inshallah, Jannah, 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 Jannah.